We're going to start flowing right into the discussion. We are, it is myself and Mr. Malorian.
Hey, take it away. How's it going?
Pretty good.
Are you excited to finally get back to this new, you know, podcast? I was just rename it. Let's be like, you know, Shoulda Vaccinated or something like that.
I love it. I love that. Shoulda Vaccinated, Shoulda Boosted.
That, oh, there you go. You got
there
it.
There we go. Yeah. That's the touch. That's that little fine touch. So what are we talking about today?
So we have two new Archons to talk about. These ones got spoiled out just this last week. So we have the new Death Archon and the new Defiled Archon. And the first thing I want to make sure, because I've been hearing some different things from people, are these the final rules, or are these going to be the first version and then there'll be another tweaking before it releases?
From what I understand, and I mean, I'm not a professional CID player. I do play CID, but I usually, when they release rules like this, they are the final ones. I would believe that we could see them in CID though. I don't know either way concrete. But I could see these being final rules. I think Hungerford's the only person that's going to know the answer to that one. Or maybe Faye.
Mm-hmm. It's just a weird world right now. Who knows what's going to happen with them, right? I mean, I would guess, because they can't actually do a full regular CID, that these are the rules. And if anything, it'll be a year away to the next dynamic update, you know, in 2021, that may they be updated. So I'm guessing the rules we're talking about right now are going to be what you're going to be seeing.
You are so wrong, sir. It is November 23rd when we see our super secret dynamic update.
Well, I meant the next one, the one after this one.
What was the last one? The last one was what, 6 months ago?
Something like that. Who knows?
I think they're doing it once every six. I would like to see them do it once every 6 months. Just do a nice little, be like, we don't want input from other people. We see how everything is going. We're just going to dynamically update this.
That's how it should be.
I think that a lot of things should be like that. Give the designers their control.
I believe what you said, the way that we're going to be covering this is that we're first going to give our hot take on them, and then we'll get into them a little bit more deeper, right?
Absolutely. I think that's a great idea.
So maybe we'll start with the Defiled Archon. So the Defiled Archon, should I give a little rundown first, or do we want to do the hot takes, and then we'll actually talk about why we have those hot takes?
You do the rundown from top to bottom. I have the sheet up on them so people can actually see, because I'm actually streaming this, guys. If you guys are interested in taking part in some of these recordings and asking questions, you can actually join us while we record this. But I do have the sheet up if you want to do a rundown on it.
All right. So the Defiled Archon is a Grimkin solo. It has 12 boxes, speed 6, strength 9, mat 7, rat 3, nothing that matters, defense 13, armor 18, command 10 for what it matters, FA 2, point cost 8. It's a large base, and it has flight. It has divine manifestation, so it's not a living model, cannot be knocked down, can't suffer blind, and it can't be taken control of. It also has this gatewalker. So what this does is, once per activation, immediately after this model casts a spell, you can place this model anywhere completely within 5 inches of its current location. So a little bit like, you know, Void Archon jumpy. It has magic ability 8, and it has 3 different abilities you can do. It can do desecration, which is an action. Place a 5-inch AoE anywhere completely within this model's command range. The AoE remains in play for the round, and enemy models treat the AoE as rough terrain. While in the AoE, enemy models suffer -2 to attack rolls. It also has Hellfire, which is a star attack. It's a range 10, power 14, magical attack, and models disabled by Hellfire cannot make tough roll, and if they're boxed, they're removed from play. And then the last one is Influence. It's a range 10 magical attack. Take control of target enemy non-warcaster, non-warlock warrior model. The model immediately makes one basic attack, then Influence expires, and then the model can be affected by Influence only once per turn. It also has Torment of Blasphemy. This model gains boosted magic attack and damage rolls. Additionally, when this model hits an enemy model with a magic attack, that model suffers an arcane attraction for one turn. And what that means is that when the friendly model casts a spell targeting a model suffering from this, it gains +3 range. As this is one kind of caught me off guard. I would have thought it was like giving me an extra like to hit or damage, but no, it's a range thing. It also has Twist the Eternal. When an enemy model within this model's command range gains a soul token, they immediately suffer the fire continuous effect. And then you have Unleash the Arcane, where once per turn, when this model hits an enemy with a magical attack, immediately after attack is resolved, it can make one additional magic ability special attack. So gets two. And then the weapon it has is the Lawbreaker. It is a range 2, P plus S14, and this magical weapon has Dispel. So when it hits things, upkeeps go away. So there's me talking a whole bunch. So, you know, Iain, what are your thoughts on this?
Right off the bat, this is the Grimkin Archon. This is what... Grimkin players have been really hoping for some. I imagine Grimkin players have been waiting really, really intently for this Archon. He offers a lot to a lot of the casters. I mean, King of Nothing has lots of play with him, being able to have that arcane attraction. Influences has been really good as of late. You and I have both been on the receiving end of a influence attack. By losing our Gaspies.
well, this is not the one that makes them move, right? This is the influence like what the Cephalix have. So this is quite a bit different.
Oh, you're right. It is too. So roll that back. So yeah, it'll just still being able to get that on Gaspies would still be really cool and then bounce back. But Hellfire, Desecration, Hellfire are... We'll just talk about those two abilities for a second. Five-inch AoE anywhere within this 10-inch command range remains in play for one round, and you can drop two of them. That's a whole lot of difficult terrain. And when you start taking a look at Wanderer, when they start trying to chug through that terrain and then also have to deal with Starcross Desecration Ground, that's terrible. And Hellfire... two POW 14s fully boosted. You understand how bonkers that is. That's you have two of these Archons running around. That's a dead warcaster.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting because, I mean, looking on these ones here, one of the ways I had it explained to me is like the Defiled Archon is just a more consistent, better Thamorite Archon because instead of getting like random shots, you'll always get the two. They're always boosted. And then he gets to kind of like teleport away after type thing.
And they always RFP.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Just like the kind of like the Thamorite as well.
Yeah.
The other one, though, that was interesting, I was playing and getting my butt kicked by a Grimkin player the other day. And for the other one, with putting on the AoEs, I mean, at first, it seemed like that's a lot of denial and all these things. But what their opinion was is that given this meta, it's not going to be that big of a deal. Because, I mean, the meta's full of Archons and, you know, Metal Angels and Gaspies and Colossals. And so really that rough terrain part of it, if there's not like, you know, like Pathfinder you're just giving out or anything, will probably be very small. And the minus two, they didn't think would be that big of a deal either. Now, I don't totally agree with that. I think, I mean, it'll always be a nice trick to have. And if you ever find someone without Pathfinder, oh boy, they're in for trouble. But like we were talking pre-show, and I'm sure you're about to talk about, that minus two to hit is also extremely relevant.
Yeah, when you start looking at Gorehounds at def 16, like without doing anything, Gorehounds sitting in this rough terrain at def 16, essentially, with the minus two to attack roll, with signs and portents, you're going to have a really hard time. Like, a mat seven is going to be looking for nines to hit on three dice dropping the highest. Ooh, I don't really like those odds. That's not looking that good. your average dice roll goes down a lot, and you're going to really miss a lot.
Another one I was thinking about is just them in combination with like a clockatrice, because we've all seen the tactic where a clockatrice goes in your face, does this little animus thing, and then, you know, you have a hard time getting into it because you're minus two speed. But if these things are working in unison, you're going to be catching things so that they're minus speed. They're also going through rough terrain. And then if they even get to you, well, then even this Archon, the Defiled Archon that has low defense of 13, is basically 15. And then you might have the Wanderer, like you were talking about, the Clockatrice, which was always that hard to deal with.
Don't forget Labyrinth. I mean, because nobody's ever got their got their entire battle plan screwed by Labyrinth.
A front line of like, you know, two of these and a Clockatrice, or two of these and three Clockatrice, whatever it's going to be, you know, like that's just going to be hell to try and deal with. And also, whereas like some of the other Archons, when they get up there and stuck in combat, they can't really do very much. Even things like the Thamrite with Perry has to back up to actually be effectual. Well, these guys, they're just casting spells. So they can just be up there jamming things and just shooting away with their magic.
Literally pop and drop. They're just going to hit somebody with a gate, hit something, and then gatewalker out. And then put more rough terrain in between him and the and whatever's trying to chase him.
So in your mind then, I guess we're going for these kind of like hot takes. You know, in the world where all these Archons are rated, do you see these? Like, let's even just go in like top and bottom half. Is this a top half new Archon or bottom half?
Definitely top half. For a couple of reasons. One, because Grimkin doesn't have access to many Archons that they really want to run. I mean, the Primal Archon's cool, but this thing is so much more cool. Let's be real. And they have this thing has way more toolkit around it. Honestly, I really think that those 5-inch AoEs are going to be super egregious. I know that the argument of Strange Bedfellows is there. That isn't going to be sitting there for very long, or it's not that it's not going to be there for very long. You can there's only a limited number of people that are going to be playing Strange Bedfellows all the time.
Well, it's also going to be a thing that's going to determine the meta. So just like how Grimkin before would take all the Gremlin Swarms and that skewed the meta because you had to take magical attacks and your jacks were just worse. So people were kind of shifting away from War Machine and taking more Hordes factions. Well, now because of this, you'll have to take Pathfinder. And if that's in combination, I mean, if you ever play someone that either A, doesn't have magical attacks, or B, doesn't have Pathfinder, this list, which probably has all those things together, will just be a monster. Because I guess again, there's your little thing. You have two of these Archons and a Clockatrice in the front, and you got four Gremlin Swarms in front of them, again, taking up some space.
I want to try, like, these Defiled Archons are so interesting that I'm really looking at playing, because I play a lot of War Table. I'm sure if anybody's looked at my channel, there's a lot of people that see me playing War Table. And what I want to try is two Defiled Archons, two Clockatrices, two Cage Ragers, basically two of everything, all the way down. That's what I want to try. And two Gorehounds, two of each of the heavies, and I want to try that. I want to try running that and see how everything links together. I haven't figured out the caster yet, because King of Nothing is something I want to really try with this list, and I also really want to try Wanderer. So
now here's the other thing I'm wondering about is that in a world that's also like in this non-existent meta that is trying to counter Agathon and taking anti-magic tech, will that spill over here? That the people trying to take all the Orins of the world and stuff like that to try and shut down magic, whether that will also make things tougher for the Defiled Archon? And I mean, of course, that there's no answer to this because there is no meta, but what do you kind of think about that?
I don't think it's prevalent enough that people are like, there's not enough of a meta to be able to say this is the meta. Mm-hmm. I mean, Agathon's a beast of his own, and if he's prevalent in your meta where you're playing, then you'll tech farm. I don't think that these guys are going to get caught by the Agathon tech either.
Mm-hmm. Either way, I just think it's really interesting and really fitting for the faction and for, you know, with them. We're like, come on, we have no Archons we can take type thing. I think this is the perfect thing for them to have.
Absolutely. And I love the way that they like these guys don't have Soul Ward. Also, hey, Hungerford or whoever wrote that insider, the Thamrite also doesn't have Soul Ward. Mic drop. But when somebody takes a soul from the within his control area or command area, they get set on fire. I love that little holdover from the Defiled Menite Archon sort of thing. Very, very cool.
Yeah, it seems to be like a more of a fluffy thing. I don't know if it's actually ever going to be that effectual inside the game, but, you know, maybe it could come up.
I don't know. If you look at, say, a Void Archon that gets set on fire, or there's a lot of things that don't want to be set on fire in this game. I mean, it's 2 damage if a turn for every, on average dice, every time that it takes a damage roll. 2 damage on a Void Archon. Void Archons are already high enough. When they start getting chipped down, it's not a good thing.
Yeah, but at the same time, it seems like anything that's going to be chipped down like that already has pretty high armor. And I mean, like, doing 2 points to a Void is like, normally when a Void's going down, it's because it's getting punched in the face with a jack, and 2 hitboxes won't really change that. But I mean, why not, right? As a little bonus thrown in there, why not?
It makes a difference between having to commit a heavy. If it takes 4 damage over 2 turns, it makes a difference between having to commit a heavy or having to commit a handful of infantry instead.
Yeah, I mean, it can, absolutely, yeah. So, I mean, with this here, here's another thing I want to kind of talk just quickly as like a little aside, is it's probably going to be a while until we actually see these models. And because, especially in this case, the fluff is that it's a Defiled Archon. Do you think it will actually be very prevalent that people are just going to be converting their own from what Archons they have available?
I think it would be kind of cool. I'd like to see what people are going to be offering. I don't necessarily know exactly how people are going to be doing it, but with the amount of time that we have on our hands in between games in this world, I think we're going to see some amazing stuff. And I really hope to see some amazing stuff.
Yeah, I'm guessing there'll be a lot of conversions, and I'm really looking forward to seeing them. But maybe just even on that, like, what do you think of the model? Like, just we went over the rules, and I think we both agree that it's a pretty fantastic rule wise. But what do you think, even just like model, like from how it's been crafted?
Okay, so let me preface this with, I really like the model. I like the model, the way that it's been colored up and shown in the Insider. Mm-hmm. However, it shows a lot. I'm not saying that the people who are sculpting these are borrowing from anybody, and I wouldn't ever insinuate it. Everybody has their own style, but it does appear to have a lot of Stormcast, Age of Sigmar, not symbolism, but it has a lot of. It looks like it has a lot of lending from that, which is I'm okay with. But I've heard the comment from other people that they're like, oh, what are they doing? Like, why would they make this? And this isn't necessarily people who play War Machine. It's people who have just seen the model in a vacuum. Mm. So I like the model. I like the nice little bit of darkness that it has to it. I love that the mask is kind of reminiscent of Heretic. So I'm pretty okay with the model. I like the book on a stick.
I don't. I mean, my kind of thoughts is like, I like the wings. I like the whole like faces that you see in there. Yeah. And I kind of wish they did the same thing for his actual face. If it was just kind of like, you know, like the new Joker where like the face was cut off and then like stapled back on. But I mean, if you want to do that, you could always just green stuff it. But that weapon seems very uninspired. And I know it's a stupid little, you know, means nothing thing, but the book physics bugs me. But, you know, like I kind of feel like if that's another easy conversion, right? If you don't like that bookend, snip it off, put something else nasty on there, and you're off and ready to go.
Pretty much. I understand that. And I mean, a big hammer would look really cool too. Like the Lawbreaker, be like, yeah, put a big hammer on him. That's cool too. I do like the book, and I do like the little, not purity seal, but purity seal add-ons into it. Hmm. The aesthetic overall is super cool. It's like a combination of chaos and like, it looks like a 40K model. It does. It looks like a 40K model, which I appreciate, and I'm okay with that. I like Games Workshop models. Some people think that it's a bit of too close to certain people's design realm. I don't care. I like it.
All right. So all in all, with how the model looks and how the rules are and what it's going to do for the faction, give it a letter grade.
Oh, B plus, A minus, somewhere in there. I think it's very, very strong piece. I think that they will be put into many, many lists. I think it'll be one of those things. Why wouldn't I take a Defiled Archon in my list when I have the opportunity to?
I'm in the same. I'm a B. I'm a solid B with this. You know, a few things of the model bug me, and a few things of the rules seem like, but I think overall, the things that bugs me of the rules are just kind of like nice to haves, and the stuff that makes it great is still there. So it's a good model. Moving on to the Death Archon, Iain, I think it's your turn to talk for 5 minutes.
No, you're gonna have to. I just put something in my mouth. I'm chewing.
Dang.
Sorry.
All right, so we're going to move on to the Death Archon. This is a mercenary minion solo. This one here has 15 boxes, and what it is it's speed 6, strength 9, mat 7, rat 3, defense 14, armor 17, command 10, FA2 again, you know, point cost 8 again on a large base. And the first thing it has here is animosity for other types of archons. So this model cannot be part of any army that includes other types of archons. The mercenary factions it works for is it can go into Convergence, Crucible Guard, Crix, Signar, Kador, Menoth, and Retribution. And then for minions, it can go to Circle, Grimkin, Legion, Scorn, and Troll Bloods.
It works for everybody, right? Is there anybody that doesn't miss? Who doesn't work for?
I believe it's everything. I'm sure now I'm forgetting something.
No, I think it worked. Like, when they just, like, it's a little side note. Mercenary, everyone, minion, all factions.
Yeah.
Like, just make it easy.
I mean, this way, if they ever come out with, like, another limited faction, they're going to have to errata everything.
Yeah, why don't they just say, minion, all factions, mercenary, all factions. Done. Finished. Why not future-proof it?
We'll get there.
It
has flight, and then it has Carnage Incarnate. This model begins the game with one corpse token. At any time during its activation, this model can spend corpse tokens to gain one of the following effects for each token spent, and each effect lasts for one round. So the first one here is Annihilator. This model gains an additional die on melee attack and damage rolls against living models. When a living model is destroyed within 3 inches of this model, it never generates a soul token. It also has Mortal Fear. While in this model's command range, living enemy models suffer -2 to damage rolls. Then it also has Sidestep. So when this model hits an enemy model with its initial melee attack or special attack, it can advance an extra 2 inches after the attack is resolved. It has Divine Manifestation, which is the same thing as it was on the other Archon. It has Necro Harvester, which a 10. When an enemy living or undead model is destroyed within 10 inches of this model gains the destroyed model's corpse token. When a friendly living or undead faction model is destroyed by continuous effect, enemy attack, or collateral damage from enemy attack within 10 of this model gains the destroyed model's corpse token. This model can have up to 3 corpse tokens at any time. It also has Vendetta for other types of Archons. So this model gains boosted attack and damage rolls against other types of Archon models. And then the weapon it has, or weapons, are going to be the Iron Reapers. It has 2 of them. The Range 3, P plus S15, of course, like, you know, magical. And they have Blood Reaper. So when this model makes an initial attack with its weapon, it makes one additional attack with this weapon against each model in its line of sight that is in this weapon's melee range. So basically Thresher.
It's Thresher. Yeah. Or Flashing Blade, whichever way you want to look at it.
It also has Chain Attack Death Chill, so if this model hits the same model with both of its initial attacks with this weapon, the model hit becomes stationary for one round. And you know, even though Archons with that Divine Manifestation are immune to a lot of things, they're not immune.
They can still be stationary. Yeah.
So, like, what are your thoughts? What are your hot takes on this, Iain?
Hits real hard. I've tested this once in a theme that I think it could be taken in. Annihilator. Why not? be like, that's real cool. Give me an additional die so I can continue boosting through other mechanics. Mortal Fear, I have not tested it only because situationally, it can be very, very strong. However, you need to make sure that your corpse economy can sustain that one. And Sidestep might be the most default one. Like, Annihilator is good, but Sidestep is what you want to be using initially, because you go in, you charge, you thresher through a whole bunch of stuff, then you sidestep deeper, and then you just annihilate her, and then you wreck everything else around you. If you're going in with the chain attack death chill, you're going to be going in against like two or three heavies, doing a bunch of damage twice, and then you're also going to be stationarying all of them to really ruin their fury economy. Necro Harvester, it's just corpse collection. It's pretty simple on that. I mean, I understand why they made it 10 inches specifically rather than command, but it's unfortunate. Vendetta, hunting other Archons is what this thing is going to do. And I don't think that's its main role. I think its main role is just hunting infantry, living infantry.
Yeah. So maybe I can then jump in here with my thoughts. And my thoughts are that I find this really disappointing. I think they completely missed the mark with this rule set for this Archon, because here this is supposed to be this thing where it's this pissed off Archon that's like, oh, why are these things going out there and doing these things? I'm going to kill all these Archons. And it's just really seems to be off base. Now, here's what it really bugs me from the rule set. One, it's anti-Archon tech doesn't seem to be anti-Archon tech enough. I mean, when I think about how if there's multiple Archons on the table and one's fighting the other, I don't really see this one doing that much better to take out other ones than any other type, right? In fact, I think normally you're better off being one of the ranged ones or something like that. But like, for example, if this one and the Defiled Archon were facing off against each other, well, the Defiled one just has the benefit of the doubt. So I kind of feel that there should have been extra there. Like maybe it gets armor piercing against Archons. Maybe it gets +4 armor when being attacked by enemy Archons or something like that. It just really seems like that anti-Archon aspect wasn't pushed enough. And then for some reason, it's more so just there to kill more infantry. And of course, here I am. I'm a guy that loves infantry, so I feel these things more. But why is everything anti-living? You would think that just like he's there harvesting all the, you know, the souls or the corpses that he finds out there, well, shouldn't he be also going after all the undead ones too? Being like, wait a second, you're supposed to be dead. You're coming with me. So this seems to be like a lot more hate for living models when really it should just be kind of everyone type thing. So it seems like conceptually, this is supposed to be something that rises up to go and kill off these other Archons and make sure that all the corpses are going where it's supposed to. But really, it's just another anti-infantry piece.
I can't disagree with you with that. The model gains boost attack and damage rolls against other Archon models. I think it should get like a bloodthirst mechanic against other Archons. Like Vendetta bloodthirst Archon would be super cool. That would give an additional. And I think Annihilator should also be added to Archons against living enemy models or living models and living and Archons. Oh. Emmanuel, thank you very much for subscribing.
So, I mean, here's a question about what it's supposed to be doing. Like a lot of people out there are, you know, there's definitely a portion of people out there that are bothered by Archons. They don't like how the meta was being taken over by Archons. You were seeing, you know, 4 in every list type thing, if not 2. And then the one counterpoint you could give is that these death Archons are going to be coming out there and making sure that kind of balances itself. Do you see the death Archons actually reducing the number of Archons we'll see in the eventual meta?
No, I don't see that changing. I see people who take Void Archons that were taking them for the anti-infantry, and I see them plugging these guys in instead for some of us. The only issue where your issue is about the anti-Archon Archon not being sustained, my issue is that these guys aren't 8 points.
Mm-hmm.
These guys are not 8 points. these guys should not be 8 points.
I mean, the only thing that I see that it will be controlling in the meta is that we were talking about formations where there's Clockatrices and two Defiled Archons. And of course, you saw that with the other ones where the Morrowinds and the Thamorites were working together and they're all buddy-buddy. That you don't want to do, because if you have all your Archons together in one little basket, this Death Archon is going to come in there. It's going to thresher. It's going to stationary them all. And that's definitely like where its big win is. So it's going to break up those baskets where you're not going to be seeing a bunch of Archons in one spot, but otherwise I don't see people, you know, changing their list because of the Death Archon. I think it, like you say, it will be people taking out Void Archons or doing like anti-infantry work already and then swapping them out. Or the other one that's interesting is because of Mortal Fear, where it's -2 to damage rolls, it might fit into armor skew type lists where you have a bunch of jacks or something, and then this thing's there in the middle saying I'm going to kill any infantry that jam me, and basically all the armor over here is +2.
Yeah, I agree with that. That anti-Archon narrative is dead on arrival on this guy. It's just not there. He is a super cool model. He's a great super solo. And I think there's some casters that really crank him up to 11, but they definitely missed a mark on the anti-Archon. What kind of casters do you see him playing with?
I mean, one of the ones that I'm thinking of, and I mean, like, coming from the Signar side, I'm not really seeing a lot there at all that I'm really overly looking towards it for having. But for the mercenary side, I could be seeing something like with Magnus II or with Bartolo type thing, Montador. But the big thing is that we don't know yet what themes they're going to be playing for. So I would assume, I mean, we didn't talk about the Blighted Archon, that it'll be allowed in both themes, but we have no idea where this Death Archon is going to be allowed. And I'm sure that's going to be part of the dynamic update that's coming out. But I mean, if it's not allowed in irregulars, I mean, it's going to be always so much more tempting to be taking the other Archons instead, I think, as far as a mercenary player goes.
I think what we're going to be seeing in what I would be is someone like Shay, Azazello, Rask. Rask is good. Like Rask is going to be all over this. But Shane Azazello, I think Azazello will run the best Death Archon in the game. Be like, let's put Storm Rager on this guy. Pile plus strength 17, with Storm Rager on him. And I think he goes up to POW 20 on feet turn, and he goes up to arm 20 something, 22 or 23 on just one. Be like, it's going to hurt so much stuff.
Yeah. I mean, like, yeah, Storm Rager is always great on any of the Archons type thing.
Yeah. And Rask is going to boundless charge him and put Fury up on him, or Rage, whichever one it is. It's going to be insane. These things are going to be insane. A 3-inch thresher with Rage or Storm Rager and just anything that can stay that can keep it friendly faction is going to be unbelievable.
Absolutely.
I'm really looking forward to seeing what I'm going to be watching very intently and what themes. I believe that Strange Bedfellows may get these.
No, they better not.
Oh my God. It's going to be
they
so
they have
bad
enough.
What are you talking about? They're super limited, super not able to take much faction.
Let's just say that if PP, seeing all the war table games and seeing how the Strange Bedfellows is kind of like taken over type thing, if they say, you know what, they need more options, they are clearly blind.
They need the people. God of death. They need the God of death in their list. What themes could you see them going? Because I could... the reason why I say that I could see them going into this Death Archon specifically going into Strange Bedfellows, Defiled are going to go into both the Grimkin themes, which is going to be a super easy plug-in.
I think when it comes to, say, Signar, it's going to be everything except for flames. You know, basically any theme that's not dedicated to one of these other faction type things, which in Signar is really only flame in the darkness. And then when it comes to mercenaries, same thing, flame. And then maybe you could also say Lelies. I'm not sure, but I'm just really.
Do you think it's just going to be a single one, or do you think it'll be? Do you think it's just going to take up your merc slot, sort of thing?
Oh, for when it comes to Signar.
Yeah.
Yeah, it would be your merc slot. Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't think they're going to actually throw it into one of the themes to actually let you use it type thing.
Yeah, it would be really tough to see which factions actually get them put into theme, like called out in theme.
Kind of like how the Void Archons. Because if they don't do that, then it will have to be in flames, right? Because as a Signar player, if there's nothing stopping you from taking those spots, it'll go into flames. So maybe they'll do like a dynamic update to say that flames can't include this or something.
Maybe. It's very similar to how Convergence was kind of like getting really limited exposure, and they ended up getting the Void Archon, but it didn't go friendly faction for Convergence. It just went into Clockwork Legions, as an example.
Where interesting thoughts or ideas I'd heard is that if you were ever in a theme or out of theme that did not allow you to take an Archon already, those were going to be the ones that let you take this, just to make sure that everybody gets an Archon. But then that wouldn't make sense, because first of all, there'd be some sort of like rule on it that would actually say that. And then also, there'd be no reason to have the animosity, right? If you can't include it in a spot that has other ones, why even have that rule? So, I don't know. They might just say everywhere.
Yeah, it might be. I mean, that's why I was kind of leaning toward specific fellows, because it calls out Void Archons, but no other Archons.
I just had an epiphany, and I want to see what you think of my idea.
Oh, no. Let me lean up in my chair and get my microphone real close to my face to find out what is happening here now.
Don't do that, because your mind's about to explode. You know how we can go into every single faction? You know what can go into every single faction?
Goblins.
The Mysterious Hermit. My prediction is that the Hermit is the Death Archon. Boom, mic drop.
I can't say the words that will... The thought patterns that are going through my head right now, I can't say live, because I'm going to be judged by people all around the world for how dumb you are. I love you, Brian.
Is there any fluff out there that proves me wrong?
I don't know fluff well enough to do that. I'm going to get Lord Nero involved in this. I'm going to get him to look at this recording at the 41-minute mark and be like, can you tell us how dumb either myself or Brian are in thinking that the Death Archon and the Hermit are the same, or not? So let's have him prescribe us what level of dumb we are. But that is an interesting take. However,
you heard it first here, folks.
However, I'm going to pop your bubble a little bit, and the Hermit is an Iosian, which makes him an elf.
Well, what says that this guy's not an elf?
That the Death Archon, it's an FA2 model. It's not this guy. He's FA2.
Yeah, that's true. I think that this should have been a character. I think there's something missing from that one, but
I think that he should have been a character as well. Actually, I think they should have made Death, literal Death, the embodiment of Death. He should have been FAC, and they should have jacked him up to like a 13. Bear with me, a 14-point single model, kind of like how Gatsby is. Hmm. Give him stuff that's kind of like Gatsby, but make him even more badass without a dumb unit attached to him or requiring more checkpoints.
I'd be all for that.
I would be too. I would be super cool. They're not going to do that. I'm not going to say never. They're not going to do that.
Now, we didn't get to talk about the model yet. So what do you think about the actual model design?
Oh, I love the model. I've actually kind of chatted with one of our other local meta players. Let me forget. I didn't have a chance to chat with him, but both of us had the exact same idea, and we're both going to go get Darksiders models, like War and Death, to do these models, because these things instantly remind me of that franchise. They're super cool. I really enjoy those models intently, and I look forward to painting them eventually. But it gets into another big issue, which is, when do I buy them? Do I buy them now and start working on them and painting them? Like, Privateer Press would assume that I'm a good gamer and would buy all my stuff in waiting and for when all of this ends. Or am I saving all my pennies and doing home improvements, and I'll wait until this entire shaboggle calms down and I can start playing tabletop games again face to face? So,
or do both.
Just blow the paycheck. Just destroy just destroy my wallet. Just my wallet's looking at me like, no.
See, my thoughts on the model is, like, at first when I saw the bone wings in the drawing, I really didn't like it. But when I saw it here in execution, it's growing on me. I think, like, the front spikes are a little bit big, but it's not that bad. The one thing that does bug me about the model is, much like how, like, the book physics for the other one, the scythe physics for this one. Because, I mean, first of all, if you think of how you would swing a scythe, it would not be pointing back towards you. It'd be pointing out. And if you're floating around just, like, casually holding a scythe, it wouldn't be heavy part up. So I think, you know, when I get mine, I'm going to have to snip that and just turn it around. Again, it's a minor thing. But otherwise, you know, I really like the direction they went with this model here.
I do appreciate the way that they have the models pointed for a couple reasons. One, transportability. Two, I do like the idea of using the back end of a scythe to hammer on somebody, kind of like a hammer. They have really nice butt ends. If we're talking about a model, practicality. And I do like that. I mean, I would like to see a little bit more of a dynamic pose. However, and I'm sorry, Mark, we have disagreements on this all the time, and Hamilton, who does the actual sculpting this, I'm sure he enjoys this, but I always have the same complaint about a lot of the models that are coming out, especially the Archons. You need to stop putting stuff on the tabards, on the loincloths. Please stop it. My only critique that I have about, and it's almost nothing. Like, it really isn't something that will stop me from buying this model, but I really am getting sick of loincloth bases.
I don't really care about that. I mean, I guess for this one here, I'd like to see, like, more of, like, a pillowy smoke thing like they did with the Infernal Masters, but it doesn't bother me that much.
The pillowy smoke thing, would be kind of cool. But yeah, the model, the weapons, they nailed that model, the model's weapons so well, it's not even funny. And the empty cloak, I can't wait to see Tyson or somebody plug an LED in there.
Oh yeah, for
and
sure.
And cast it in clear. It's going to look super cool. I would love to see this model in their clear resin, just so you can get that LED plugged in, like either a blue LED or a green LED or something like that, just to get that real nasty. I don't want to say Crixian feel to it, because this model is going to be painted very Crixian by a lot of people, I imagine.
Oh, no. You know mine's going to be pink. That's the way it goes.
Well, you have two of them, so. I don't think I painted any pink models yet. I think I'm the only one in our own little gaming collective that hasn't done the pink model.
Oh, come on. You got to give in.
I know. I just haven't done it yet.
So for this one here, the Death Archon, given, you know, the rules and its effect on the faction and its model and all that stuff, what's your letter grade here? You gave a B+ to the other one.
This one, I have a hard time letter grading this one. And I know 99% of people should just be like, shut up, Iain, and say A or A-. My issue is that I don't like what they've done with the point cost. I think the point cost needs to be higher. And that actually causes me to question a little bit about this model. I think that it's going to get increased in cost between now and when we see it live. And if they don't, PP, what the hell are you doing? It is way too effective for 8 points. Yes, it is an A, flat out. And depending on theme, it's only going to get better than an A or an A minus. I don't want to give an A plus because an A plus means that it's like an A plus means that something is broken. Mm-hmm. And this one is like right on that cusp of being really stupid. It has a lot of rules. And for 8 points, look at the stuff around you. That's 8 points, like Warjacks.
So I guess we're really going to differ here. Cause I mean, first of all, for my letter grade, I'm going to give this thing a C minus, mainly because I feel that the rules are way off from what it's supposed to be doing. But as well, and this will be coming to your point cost thing, is that at the end of the day, this thing is not overly survivable. You know, in this meta of Gaspy fours racing across the board, this is just going to be another easy model to take down with that. What it's really doing then is that this is an anti-infantry model. However, it's competing with the same point cost of Void Archon, and potentially depending on what faction we're talking about. And the Void Archon is just so much more versatile in its ability just to, like, I punch here and teleport behind you and then spray across and, you know, buy attacks. And it just seems like this guy is going to have such
a... Void Archon can't buy attacks.
Sorry?
Void Archon can't buy attacks.
Are boosting the attack, sorry. But the thing is, like, this, as opposed to a Void, where you're like, okay, anything on the board is open to its attacks. Well, for this Death Archon, it's always going to be very straightforward where it's going and what it threats. And to me, I just don't see it being up there. Like, it sounds from what you're saying that this is, like, either the best or the second best Archon in the game. Whereas to me, like, he's falling down to the bottom half for when I'm looking at, like, from a power level. So let's quickly talk about that. Like, where do you see
this? He's a viable super solo. Let's be real here. He's a viable super solo. He can go in against, he can go in and stationary two living war beasts, be it heavies or whatever you want to be hitting, and then have the rest of them come in and be like, you can sacrifice these things. 8 points to go in and stationary three models. Potentially, when they go in, they have 3-inch thresher, and they're mat 7, and they're going to be hitting living and just wrecking them. You suicide these things in, and they're going to be trading up. And don't, like, let's be real here. When we're talking about static threat ranges, there's nothing static about these guys. They're speed 6. They're threading 12 inches right off the bat before they even do anything crazy. Before you add in any other kind of threat extension, which, you know me and doing super dumb threat extensions, he's going to be silly. He's going to be getting in deep and getting into those vectors that you don't want him to get into with the sidestep and potential other shenanigans. And when you see him with Azazello, when you see him with Azazello, he's going to hurt you and he's going to put you in a place where you've never thought you've ever been put before.
Oh, and I'm sure there's going to be spots where it's amazing. But I mean, at the same time, the Rask player or whatever will be like, what do I want to attach this package of buffs to? Is it going to be Eminem? It's going to be this guy, whatever. But the big thing is, like, when I think of when it actually attacks in a game, if it's going against infantry, take stationary out of there, right? It's not going to do anything because it's dead anyway. If it's anything like a Jack, that's not where you want to be because this guy is not going to go and take out a Jack, and then that Jack's going to be able to take this guy out. So it really seems like what it wants to do is either prey on infantry or it needs to be in a spot where it's taking out Archons, because even like living war beasts, it'll go in and be like, haha, I hit you twice and stationaried you. And even if I did something significant, they're going to shake, they're going to heal, and they're going to kill your Archon.
That's not what these guys are doing. These guys are setting up the kill. You go in with him into ghetto. You go in, you hit him, you do 4 dice damage on the first swing. And if you're being generous and allocate something over to him in some kind of way, he's POW 15 base. He goes to POW 17 or 18, depending on the buff that you give him. Even higher if you have a feat that can do it, that can attach. Yeah, he's not going to be two-shotting a heavy, but he's 8 points. You're putting him up toe-to-toe and comparing him to something that's like 16, 18, 20 points.
I mean, Brian, isn't that damage?
You're comparing him to something that's twice his points or 2.5 times his points. That's respectable enough on its own.
Well, no, I'm just thinking about the targets it's actually going to go after. And I mean, when you're thinking of how you're going to be playing it, because I know you plan on putting this in your Strange Bedfellows.
Well,
you're
100%.
Talking about, yep, like, I'm going to go into something living and I'm going to stationary it and I'm going to do some damage. That's what your unit of angels are doing anyway. And they're
paralyzing. They're paralyzing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And again, setting it up so that their defense goes way down so that something else can take it out.
Well, it makes it so I can switch, I can change up my vectors. Because I can put my angels out in three different targets, or two and one, to be able, because they're stationary already, so I don't have to worry about the paralyze.
Maybe we should jump to something like this. What would be currently, assuming these rules are final, out of all the archons in order, what are your top three archons in the game power wise?
Void, Death, and the third one depends on what I'm playing against, because that third spot is super up in the air. And I know that it's rough for me to be able to quantify, because the Mad-Eyed Archon is a beat stick.
Mm-hmm.
The Morrowind is super defensive and is absolute force multiplier. By force multiplier, I mean defensive and being able to hold an area. The Dunian is incredible for 6 points with the right list. It makes it so frustrating to try and kill things. And I think it's in the middle and close up to the top. I think the Death Archon is incredible in its own. And it's hard for me to put a third Archon. Void, and the only reason why I'm so quick to say Void is because I have so much exposure with the Void and I have used him to such a large effect.
So I would also say my number one is the Void, which already should be alarm bells, because in a lot of lists, I think those two Archons are going to be competing against each other for the same spot. But to me, I would have number one being the Void Archon, number two being the Menite Archon, and then number three, I'm actually going to go with the Defiled Archon from what it can actually give and what it can do. So, I mean, like, I'm now getting past and down to all the other ones it might be up against, but I mean, I just don't see it being overly that popular. I think the real spots where you're going to be seeing this then, because it's really like, again, if you're going against anti-infantry, well, then you might just go for the Void. You might even just go for a Thamorite or something like that, especially when you got to think about this, where in those cases where it's not even a one for one, right? For in Strange Bedfellows, it's either I'm taking the Void or I'm going to be taking the Death. But in other ones, it'll be like, do I want the ability to take one or two Death Archons, or do I want the ability to be taking four Archons with having the Menites and the Thamorites and the Morrowinds?
Oh, absolutely agree with that one. The issue for me, also, I would have liked to say that Defiled is the third, but I didn't, only because it's Grimkin only, and I don't think that would be a fair translation.
Fair enough.
But when you start looking at the popping up and moving around and spraying and hitting and stuff like that, Annihilator is a hell of a drug, and that's a big thing for me. And Rat 6, I have missed so many infantry with Rat 6. You can't always bounce behind them when you're looking for that. When you're looking for that, and I play my voids with Aurora. I have the fastest voids, I play them to great effect. And I still think that the two scythes are going to be superior in terms of nailing someone down. Also, if you look at it this way, if we're comparing to Infernals, be like, if Infernals have to shake and start screwing their soul, or not soul economy, one, soul economy, and two, their essence economy, because I'm stationarying everything, that's enough. I'll sacrifice 8 points for that.
Yeah, maybe.
I'm willing. I'm a soulless general. I will sacrifice 8 points if it means that I, for in the long term. Like 16 points to sacrifice two guys, I'm okay with that if it gives me a turn of breathing room.
Hey, man, I once threw away a colossal to get the scenario win, so.
It's true.
Talking about like the Archons, do you think this will be the end of it now? Is this the end of the Archon chapter for PP, or do you foresee that there'll be any more coming after this? Oh, we totally forgot an Archon, the Blight one, but let's just keep on going. Do you think there'll be any more Archons after this?
honestly, okay, when we'll bounce back to the Blight one real quick. I think Mark should be here for that one because he's far more experienced in with the Blight Archon than either of us. And coming back, rolling back to the topic at hand, I do think that that we are done the Archons. I don't want to see any more. We kind of have all the different archetypes. I also don't want anybody to complain any more about these things. I'm super done with that. I'm super done listening to people complain about these things.
Yeah, I'm guessing they're done too. I actually thought that we'd be the final thing we'd be seeing is some sort of like infernal archon, but that would really be the role that this death archon is in. I thought it was going to be like an anti, you know, other archon type thing that the infernals would have, but now this already exists.
Unless we start seeing a Haley archon, which would be kind of cool, but the time archon. And when we start seeing them get put into power gems into a gauntlet, then we can start looking at being like, okay, I think we're overdoing this.
Ooh, and we just answered one of our other questions. That's the one faction that can't take it. Infernals can't take the death archon.
Oh.
And they probably should, right?
No. They don't.
Why not?
Because they're working against the gods of Imran.
Isn't the big thing the Death Archon just be like, hey, I'm off to go and kill these guys? And maybe it figures like, hey, if I stand by these infernals where all the Archons are going to, my food comes to me.
No, they don't eat souls. They ferry the souls over to the... Come on, you know who Death is.
No, but he's going after the other Archons, right?
Yeah, he's going against the other Archons because he doesn't like them. It doesn't mean that that he can't eat as well.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's just ferrying the dead. Death ferries the dead.
I know, I know.
I mean, he doesn't care how it happens. He could be sitting beside Signar. He's the true neutral out of all of them. Because he doesn't want anybody to have any power over him. Let's be real here. He wants to see the souls make it over to the afterlife. But actually, that would be actually an interesting way to looking at it in contrast, is that he is wanting the souls to be making it over to Urkane or whatever it is. He doesn't want the infernals to take the souls, and that's why he doesn't give souls after he kills. See what I did there?
I was trying to find some way I could like twist that back into the hermit idea, but
I figured you would
that one.
I would like to see more lore. I'm really looking forward to more henchhold squirrels. I do really want to see more of those.
So we're getting up to an hour, which means we're in a closing thoughts type thing. So Iain, what are your closing thoughts on these two new Archons, and I guess the Archons in general?
Before I really put my stamp of hardcore approval on the Death Archon, I want to see what themes they're in. The Defiled Archon is such a good inclusion for Grimkin players. I can't wait to start playing them on Wartable. I am going to give them a shot in probably my next few battle reports. I'm probably going to start dipping my toes into Grimkin. Other than that, I hope these aren't the final rules for the Death Archon. I do. I hope that they get tweaked just a little bit.
Yeah, I think I'm in the same camp. I really like the Grimkin one. Of course, like I said, I think the Death one missed the mark. But yeah, I think as well, like you'd mentioned before, I'm kind of glad this is coming to an end because I know that some people have not been liking it. But looking forward, you know, seeing how beautiful some of these models are, I'm hoping this continues with whatever PP does next. And I just kind of really hope that whatever is the next kind of, you know, campaign, like the Oblivion campaign that happened, you know, whatever the next thing is going to have some, you know, key centerpiece models for that as well.
Yeah. I'm interested in seeing how they're going to be closing up this chapter of the storyline. I haven't been playing this game for as long as most people, and this is the most that I've had exposure to for lore in this game. I'm a old X40K player. I could tell you every single, a lot of 40K lore. And this is the first that I've been engaged with PP lore. So I hope that they do kind of give us a second chapter or the final chapter to all of this, or the second / final, whichever way you want to look at it, to all this and kind of see the conclusion and where we're moving forward from this point.
I think we know how it ends, right? Sturgis faked his death, then faked his undeath death, disguised himself as hermit, and now he's the Death Archon. That's the only way this goes.
Shut up.
with it. That, I know you're going live, but for those who'll be listening to the podcast after, Iain, where can they can find your stuff?
All right. So they can find me at The Community Killer on Facebook. They can find me at The Community Killer on Instagram. They can find me at The Community Killer on Twitter. They can find me at The Community Killer on YouTube. Anywhere, you just put in The Community Killer or The Community Killers, and you will find me. It will look like a moon with dice in the background and The Community Killer in big, bold letters with red and black, and looks all scary and stuff like 80s horror. So please check out those channels. And Brian, where can they find you?
Yeah, if you're wanting to find some other type of stuff and you're trying to look for something good and worthwhile to watch, just go and Google Big Top Gaming and go there instead.
Hey, you know what? We should give the Nero as well. What's his YouTube channel? If we're just going to keep popping other people's channels, it's...
I believe it's Agent of Nero, isn't it?
Is it Agent of Nero?
I can always put it down
Servant, in the show notes. Servant of Nero.
Servant.
NYRRO. Yeah, we go to his place. He has lots of lore. Also, go to LuckGod84 because LuckGod84 has constant content coming out. And he's doing an Iron Kingdoms RPG, which looks really, really interesting. And I highly recommend going to go watch that.
Perfect. All right. So yeah, lots of great stuff out there. Thanks again for listening to us. This has been episode 35 of what was that? Shoulda boosted shot it or what was that?
Shoulda boosted.
That's it.
Right. We're going to have to change the name of this every week. Every time we do this, if we do an episode every week, that'd be amazing. Okay. Thank you very much for listening, guys. And thank you very much for watching. I will catch you guys all later.
See you later.